Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cries of a Dying World by G. Michael Hopf, narrated by T.J. Clark. Prologue. Present Day. Traveling at 30,333 miles per hour and spanning over 11 kilometers in diameter, asteroid Colossus made impact 313 miles northeast off the coast of the Hawaiian Islands. The Earth shook, the seas heaved, and the planet groaned as massive chunks of itself were hurled into the lower atmosphere, only to rain back down, causing further destruction. The torrid heat from Colossus's impact encircled the globe at a horrifying and inescapable speed of over 9,000 miles per hour. The inferno scorched and sterilized the planet, leaving nothing in its wake. The impact crater covered an area over 110 miles in diameter. What lay in the miles-deep crater was nothing more than molten rock, similar to the primordial soup that had been the planet 6 billion years before. If one were to look back on Earth, they wouldn't recognize her. Gone were the vibrant colors of a once-living planet. The deep blues and greens had been replaced by a searing red and charred black. Hours after Colossus's arrival, over 7 billion people were dead. Those who had found shelter deep in the bowels of Earth would eventually look upon those who died as the lucky ones. But theirs is another story entirely. Chapter 1. 12 days before impact. 8 miles west of Ocotillo, California. Her eyes were a radiating emerald, warmed with inner seagrass. He often got lost in them, and when she'd look upon him, it would pierce his soul with cries of love and desire. Her whisper, soft and quiet enough to make him pay attention, worked. It always worked. Her touch, gentle and loving. Her lips and kisses felt like home. Her aroma, sweet and alluring like rose petals. Her body curved right where it needed, and from her beautiful face to the bottom of her feet, she was perfect. But she always lovingly reminded him that no one was perfect, and that she was simply perfectly imperfect. While he'd relent on those details, these he'd never surrender. She was an angel, his queen, his soulmate, and the love of his life.
"Ethan, I love you."
Those were her final words to him, as her radiant eyes closed for the last time. It took them an hour and 3 men to remove him from the mangled debris of shattered glass, twisted steel, transmission fluid, and blood, both his and hers. When she let out her last breath, she not only left this world, but the unborn child she was carrying went with her. The truck had come out of nowhere, or that was what he remembered. It was the police report, though, that told a different story. His blood alcohol was just over the legal limit, but he had felt fine, and they were only a mile from home. She had normally driven since becoming pregnant, but that night she was tired. What had started with a jovial birthday party for a friend turned into tragedy, and he was to blame. Out of body, surreal. There was no other way to describe how he felt as he watched them put her body in a bag while he sat in the back of a police car, his hands cuffed behind his back. Repeatedly, he pressed his eyes closed and prayed that he'd open them and all would be back as it was, the two of them holding hands and laughing, chatting about the future, baby names, and the neutral color they should paint the nursery. Yet no matter how many times he'd played this game of make-believe, using his imagination with hopes of changing the past, it never worked. He'd always open them to the reality that 11 months before, he had killed his wife and unborn child. Unable to sleep even though he needed to, Ethan lowered his window and looked out over the moonlit desert landscape. Coyotes howled in the distance. Their cries always sounded eerie to him. Whenever he heard a coyote howl, he thought of the prey they were pursuing. The animal's heart thumping as it raced to escape the jaws of death. For billions of people around the world, they too were praying and hoping to find salvation or an escape from what was coming. Maybe it was best to not know. Be like the coyote. It wasn't living in fear right now. It was hungry and doing what coyotes do. Hunt and kill. Theirs was a simple existence. Blissfully ignorant that an asteroid larger than the one that had killed the dinosaurs was hurtling towards them. He sometimes wished he too was ignorant of Earth's fate. But that wasn't to be. Nope. He had the privilege, or that was what his older brother Eric had told him. He had a spot. Two, actually. In a bunker that had been built so some would survive the apocalypse. This extinction-level event that was being caused by a piece of rock called Colossus. Who comes up with these names? He thought. Sounded like the name a screenwriter would come up with. Or maybe it was just some twisted astrophysicist's joke. Nevertheless, that was the name of this monster left over from the dawn of the solar system, which was on a collision course with Earth. It had been 2 days since the new president, not sworn in a day at the time, had gone on national television to inform Americans and the world of their fate, a fate the previous administration had known about for 5 years, but now admitted had been covered up to prevent societal collapse years before. The irony is, the powers that be weren't really concerned about the chaos of this knowledge on the average person. They just wanted the time to build their bunkers, and they had gotten the time. 5 years to plan, build, and coordinate in relative peace and prosperity, while everyone else went about their lives thinking they'd have a future. However, the new president had thrown a curveball. Those who believed they had a spot in the bunker, dubbed Ark, up until days ago, soon discovered that spot wasn't secure. With a new president comes new rules, new policies, and new political friends to help. This was why Ethan was on the side of Interstate 8, outside of Ocotillo, California, with a destination of Tempe, Arizona. Eric worked for the new president and had secured 2 seats, one for Ethan and one for Ethan's estranged son, Chance. The plane was leaving in 10 days from Hill Air Force Base in Utah. All Ethan needed to do was get there and do so in the bitter cold month of January. It seemed easy enough, but when you threw in the fact that millions of people were coming to grips with their fate, with some acting out violently, this road trip probably wasn't going to go as planned. Living was one of the last things Ethan had been doing, or even wanted to, since the accident. However, if he could save Chance, he owed him that. He had called Chance minutes after Eric had made his offer, and to his surprise, Chance had answered on the first try. Upon giving him the news, Chance agreed to go and to set aside past grievances. But before they could work out the details, the phone went dead. He hadn't been able to reach Chance since except for an occasional text, which told him Chance was okay and eagerly awaiting his arrival. A cool breeze brushed across Ethan's face, bringing with it the unique odor of creosote. In his lap, his SIG P-239 semi-automatic 9mm pistol sat. He stared at it, and even picked it up to feel the grip. He'd had the SIG for years, having bought it when he lived in Florida, and like him, it had found a home in San Diego when he moved. He and his SIG now had an unhealthy relationship, one of master and servant. And for now, he was still the master. Although there had been times over the past 11 months he'd almost surrendered his role. Life without Jen had been just bearable enough up until a couple of days ago. Then the call came at the right time. He had a purpose now, something to do and someone to help. So for right now, the SIG would remain the servant. He opened the center console and set the SIG inside. The coyotes howled again, but now their song began to lull him to sleep. Like he had done since losing her, he thumbed his phone to his voicemail, found the message he wanted, and hit play.
Hi, sweetie. I know I didn't get to say it as I was in a hurry, but I love you so much. You're my life, my sun and stars. Have a great day.
He hit play again, her words soaked into his soul. Over and over. He repeated the message until he fell asleep. Chapter 2. 8 miles west of Ocotillo, California. The horn of a car jolted Ethan awake. He sat up and quickly scanned his surroundings, looking for the source, but saw nothing. He adjusted in the seat to allow his stiff legs to stretch, before finally getting out to shake off the stiffness. The chill of the evening still hung as a wind swept over, giving him a shiver, but the deep orange in the eastern sky pretended the sun was about to crest the horizon and bring with it the warmth of the day. As he did his morning routine, he looked south across the rolling tan and brown hills. In the distance, a small single-level house stood. The stucco siding showed years of weather, with the Spanish tile roof suffering the worst, as sections were missing. As seemed typical of solitary houses in the middle of the desert, their yards always had rusted old cars, a stack of tires, and tattered furniture. This house checked all those boxes, but had one curious item Ethan found amusing. Lining the front of the house were pink flamingos. 7, to be exact. Why pink flamingos? He chuckled to himself. The whoosh of a vehicle traveling at a high rate of speed sounded behind him. He craned his head back to see a truck heading west. He wondered what their story was. Where were they headed? As he watched it speed up the hill, he said, Del Mar. Yep. They're going to Del Mar. Beach. Were they really going there? Or was he just picking the destination he had chosen for himself before the call from Eric? Upon hearing about Colossus, he had picked Del Mar Beach as his final resting spot. It was a nice beach, not the most beautiful in the world by any stretch, but it brought back many memories of him and Jen. He finished and made his way back to his truck. Hunger pangs came, along with his need for coffee, or more importantly, caffeine. He opened the center console and paused for a moment when he saw his semi-automatic pistol sitting there. He pulled it out, gave it another weary look, then set it on the dash before diving back into the console to remove the bag of jerky, along with a container of instant coffee. He opened a thermos, dumped a heaping amount of coffee into it, added water, closed it up, and shook. It wasn't his French press from home with his dark roast coffee, but it was needed to stave off the headaches of withdrawal. The end of the world had some benefits, like free gas, which he found often, but the lack of good coffee brought to the forefront the good life many had taken for granted. A car horn blared to the north of him. He shot a look, but a small hill obstructed any view further. Was this the same horn which woke him? He took a bite of the savory jerky, his mouth watering as he chewed. His eyes found the pistol again. He stared at it. The horn again blared, this time sounding for 10 to 15 seconds. His attention torn from the pistol and curious, he again looked across the highway, half expecting to see a car barreling over the hill towards him. His senses kicked in. They were something he relied upon his entire life and usually were correct. Something was wrong, and he didn't want to stay around to find out. He tossed the bag of jerky on the passenger seat, closed his door, and started his vehicle, a white Chevrolet Suburban. The radio kicked on, the volume higher than he remembered, startling him. He quickly turned it down, shaking his head in disbelief that he had spooked himself. He also got a chuckle from the song playing. It's the End of the World as We Know It, by R.E.M. Clearly the DJ had a sense of humor. He changed the channel and stopped when he heard a news report. Based upon the data we have, Colossus will not strike us directly but at an angle. The energy of the impact will be mostly directed out and up, with about 1 to 3% going down into the ground. But it'll be enough to ring the planet like a bell. We expect seismic waves will radiate across and through the Earth. As those waves move across the planet, the plates will be affected, and earthquakes of a magnitude higher than 10 will occur. To give an example, Colossus will strike northeast of the Hawaiian Islands. The seismic waves will reach the western coast of the United States within 15 minutes. Along with the quakes,
fiery debris will also be raining down, causing forests to burn. Meanwhile, the ejecta cloud from the blast will be traveling out in all directions from the impact site at a speed of 16,000 kilometers per hour. The ejecta site is superheated air. It will destroy all structures and bake the ground with unrelenting heat, and to make matters worse, millions of volts of static electricity will charge the cloud, making a vast electrical storm. This cloud will reach halfway around the world within an hour, and temperatures on the ground in Eastern Europe will reach 300 degrees Fahrenheit. Within 2 hours, the cloud will encompass the planet and bury it in a superheated darkness. A global tsunami will also be produced. A wall of water, a half mile high, traveling at speeds of over 500 miles per hour, will wipe out the coastlines. Hearing enough, he turned off the radio. Picking up the pistol, he placed it in his lap, then put the vehicle in gear. As he smashed his foot against the accelerator, a gunshot cracked in the distance. It came from the same direction as the car horn. Not needing to look, he kept his attention on the road ahead and pressed the accelerator down further. He glanced in a side mirror and could see around the hill behind him. There he saw a trailer home and two cars. He wasn't sure what was happening, nor did he care. It was times like these, high stress and uncertainty, that produced situations he was all too familiar with. Situations that still gave him nightmares. Not giving it another thought, he barreled down the road towards the rising sun. Chapter 3. Flagstaff, Arizona. Trust wasn't just a word to Melody. She embodied and expected it from all she called friend or lover. And it had become something she was finding less and less of with her fiancé, Jared. She couldn't understand why they had been fighting more and more since the announcement of Colossus's arrival, but today's fight was the worst it had ever been, resulting with him leaving. He'd said he was going out to get some air, but he'd been gone for over 4 hours. Acting as if she had a compulsive disorder, she looked at her phone several times per minute, somehow expecting to see a text message without a notification sounding. With each gaze, her heart sank, and the walls of her single-bedroom apartment became smaller. Sleep had already been a problem for her lately, from her getting up a couple of times per night to get sick, to Jared being distant and their neighbors partying to all hours of the night. She stopped at a framed photo of her and Jared. She stared at it and grew sad. The photo was from a trip to Las Vegas. They had gone to elope, but Jared had changed his mind, stating he wanted to marry her in a more dignified manner. That was 3 months ago, and 2 months after, she'd gotten the news her cancer had returned. Maybe that was a sign. Maybe he had no intention of ever marrying her. And did it even matter now? Soon they'd all be dead anyway. Although the idea of being someone's wife before she died sounded romantic, and checked off an item on her bucket list. Unnerved by her negative inner thoughts, she moved on from the photo and continued her pacing. From the living room to the kitchen and on to the bedroom, she went. Where was he? Why wasn't he answering her texts? She looked at her phone, no replies. Calling was useless as the circuits were busy, but texts were still going through. Or maybe they weren't. Was that the issue? She asked herself. She looked and saw the text notification read, "Delivered." She stopped herself in the narrow hall when she came upon a mirror. Dark circles under her sad blue eyes told a story of fatigue, worry, and disease. Why? Why is this happening to me? She was only 32. She'd already knocked on death's door 3 years before and overcame it. But cancer was a fucker, a tough opponent, and had come back with a vengeance. Now it didn't matter if she found a cure this very minute, because in 11 days, she'd be dead. And this time from an asteroid. This was why she never gambled. Her luck sucked. A selfie he had taken of them a few weeks ago came to mind. It had been a sweet photo, and she recalled how happy it made her feel. She opened her phone and went to the photos, but couldn't find it. Maybe she hadn't saved it.
Recalling he had texted it to her, she opened his text. Of course, no reply from him, and hit the arrow next to his name. Another screen popped up, and with it, a map of his location. She had completely forgotten she had the ability to track him. She had never had cause for concern, but now she did. And as if God was looking out for her, she now knew where he was. Pressing on the map, it opened a larger map. She zoomed in and saw he was a few blocks away and at a house. She grabbed her keys and raced out the door. Chapter 4. Gila Bend, Arizona. Over the years, he had made numerous trips to Phoenix from San Diego, and the one place he always stopped to rest and refuel was Gila Bend, and today would be like those times. He looked at the fuel gauge sitting just above a quarter tank. He needed gas. Now he just hoped he could get it. The town appeared normal. Nothing looked out of place, giving him a sense that he'd be safe. Then again, it was the end of the world, and anything could happen. A couple of cars passed him heading west. Again, he wondered where they might be going. A chevron sign ahead gave him his destination. As he closed in on it, he saw a large green glowing sign that read, "Open." He sighed in relief, turned right, and pulled up to an open pump. Two other vehicles were getting gas, and the occupants of the cars were out, with one group drinking alcohol, while the other group stood outside their large Suburban, armed with rifles, as if expecting a skirmish to break out at any time. He laughed to himself. Two groups of people, two different reactions. One hypervigilant, the other not giving two shits, as they would say. Just to make sure he wasn't walking into something dangerous, he did take a moment to look around. While he fell into the not-giving-two-shits camp, he was on a mission to get Chance to Utah, and he couldn't do that if he were dead. Feeling confident it was safe, he exited the vehicle. But not one to take things for granted, he slid his pistol in his waistband. With his credit card in hand, he went to insert it in the pump, but was prevented by a handwritten sign taped on the card reader. "Free gas. God bless." "Isn't that nice?" he said with a smile. He took the pump and started filling while maintaining his situational awareness. The hypervigilant group finished, loaded up, and drove off, followed by the beer-chugging group, leaving him by himself. Alone, he went to the cab, grabbed his mobile phone, and tried to call Chance. Like before, the phone played the message.
"We're sorry. All circuits are busy now. Please try your call again later."
Frustrated, he tossed the phone back inside and went to finish fueling. Topped off, he was curious if he could get water and some snacks. He locked his vehicle and made his way to the store. Stopping just before the entrance, he found another handwritten sign similar to the one on the pump. "Everything is free. God bless." Just below was a different message. "Get saved. It's not too late." Again, the sign made him smile. Some people clearly got the message about the end of the world. You can't take money with you. He entered the store to find some had taken advantage of the free option, with empty shelves for some items, specifically the beer cooler. Ethan went further down the cooler aisle to find the water was still there. Grabbing a basket, he loaded up what he could carry, nothing more, and a few more bags of jerky. As he headed for the door, two men entered. These were hard men by their looks. One had a thick scar on his neck, and the other had what looked like fresh blood on his white t-shirt. Both men gave Ethan a stare that told him they were trouble. Not one to shy away, but also not wanting to engage, Ethan made eye contact, then looked away. He maneuvered around some loose items on the floor around the men, and exited the store. With a slight turn of his head, Ethan kept the front door of the store in his peripheral vision. Parked opposite him at a pump was a black Kia Soul, not the kind of vehicle he'd expected these two rough men to drive. Making it to his vehicle, he unlocked it, tossed the entire basket inside, turned, and saw the men coming towards him. He pulled the pistol from his waist and raised it.
"I'd stop right there,"
Both men did as Ethan suggested, their arms up. Fellas, come on. Really? We need your rig, the man with the scar blurted out. For what? The world is being destroyed in about 10 days. What are you gonna do, go four-wheeling? Ethan mocked. Movement to Ethan's left caught his attention. He looked quickly and saw two more men. One had a rifle. Shit. It had been years since Ethan had even held a pistol, much less used one in any capacity. So he was a bit rusty. He was outnumbered and outgunned, as the man had an AR platform rifle. Getting into a gunfight at a gas station was about the dumbest thing anybody could do. Yet here he was. The men in front of him were 20-plus feet away, while the other two were 3 times that distance. But there was the rifle to consider. His vision began to narrow, while tension began to build. This was about to go down, and he hated it. He put all his attention on the closest threat, began to squeeze. But before he could pull the trigger on the man with the scar, a volley of gunfire came down on the men, striking them both. Ethan took cover around the far side of his vehicle. The footfalls of the other men approached, stopping next to the other two, followed by more gunfire. With a white-knuckled grip, Ethan readied himself to fight. He peered above the hood of his vehicle to find the men digging through the pockets of the now-dead men. One of them caught him looking and called out, "We're not gonna hurt you, bro. These guys stole my mom's car. We were just getting it back." "Okay," Ethan answered. He didn't know what to believe, so he decided to stay put. He followed the men's footfalls to the Kia, heard them get in, start it, and drive off. Feeling safe, he lifted his head and looked to find he was alone. Making his way around the front of his vehicle, his gaze fixed on the dead men. Stupid is as stupid does. Not wanting to wait around for another dangerous encounter, he headed out, thankful to be alive. He made one last look in his rearview mirror at the men who just moments before had been alive and threatening his life. How stupid. But does it matter? They were dead men walking anyway.
Chapter 5. Enoch, Utah.
Rust, dust, and decay. That was what one would see if they stepped foot into 3030 Minersville Highway, Enoch, Utah today. Built in 1897, the house was 2 stories with a walk-up attic, 3 bedrooms, 2.5 bathrooms, a living and family room and kitchen. The exterior of the house had all the features one would expect of a Victorian home, with its stained glass, peaked Gothic roofs, and cupolas, tall windows, ornate eaves, and a wide porch. When it was first occupied, the owner had been a prominent businessman who had moved from New York City to find his fortune in silver. From him, it went to another businessman and his family, and so forth, until Everett John Pritchard inherited it. Everett wasn't like the previous occupants. He wasn't a businessman. He didn't have a fortune, or was in the process of creating one. No, Everett just happened to be the only surviving relative when this asset became available after the death of his aunt. He had grown up in Enoch, and couldn't wait to leave to explore the world. Then along came Susan Glassman. She was the checkout clerk at the pharmacy, and upon setting eyes on her, it was love at first sight. She had moved to Enoch just months before, a traveler of sorts. Susan was a runaway who needed some quick money, so she took a job upon seeing the sign in the window. The two were inseparable, and Everett found himself falling for her hard, even though his friends warned him that Susan, or Susie, as Everett sweetly called her, was bad news. Everett wouldn't hear any of it, and dove in. It wasn't long before she introduced him to the life of drugs and alcohol she had lived since she was 14, after her parents died in a car accident. From the tragic death, she bounced from foster home to foster home, eventually leaving one night when she was 17. The two had fun and partied, and months later, she came to him pregnant. Susie didn't want to have a baby at 19, but she too had fallen madly in love. They married and had the baby, a lovely girl, whom they named Savannah. 2.5 years later, she gave birth again, a boy named EJ for Everett Jr. She played house at 3030 Minersville Highway and enjoyed her life, even giving up drinking and drugs. But for Everett, he wanted something else. He'd sit on the porch and watch the cars and trucks go north and south, and wanted nothing more than to be in one of them on his way out of town. His drinking and drug use became legend in town, with his time at home becoming less and less, until one day, he never came back. Susie would sit on the porch waiting, but days turned into weeks, then months, and now years. As she mentally deteriorated, so did the house. She went back to the bottle to soothe her pain, but that was never enough, and before long, she took her anger and sorrow of abandonment out on her children, in the most brutal of ways. The lives of her children became one of terror and torment, until she got clean 3 years past. For Savannah, now 12, and EJ, who had just turned 9, those 3 years of sobriety brought with them peace and harmony. It was as if the demon that had possessed their mother was gone, like a veil had been lifted. The memories of their torturous early years began to fade, until news of Colossus came.
"Where's Mama?"
EJ asked. His long, curly brown locks partially covered his tender 9-year-old face. He was small for his age, which led him to either be picked on at school or found to be adorable by adults. It was a curse, he said, as he'd heard his father had been tall and strapping. If one could be all consumed by something, his desire to grow big and tall was ever on his mind.
"Store,"
Savannah replied. She rocked back in the chair, her gaze just tall enough to see over the weathered railing of the porch towards Minersville Highway. She nervously fiddled with the gaping hole in the knee of her jeans. A chilled breeze washed over her and sent loose blonde hairs from her ponytail onto her face. She tucked the hairs behind her ears, her blue eyes still fixed upon the road. The house fronted the road, which was busy for a town of a little over 5,000 people. All her life, she'd been scolded not to play too close to the road and had received numerous beatings when Susie thought she hadn't listened. Taking a seat on a rusty bucket next to Savannah, EJ picked up an old broom handle and began to push around the dried leaves from the old oak tree, which had stood in the front yard for over 100 years. The yard hadn't been cut before winter had set in, leaving the now dead grass tall and appearing more like weeds. A birdbath sat opposite the oak tree. The years of neglect showed, as the white marble was stained and the bowl itself filled with murky water. The mailman pulled up, opened the mailbox, the black paint cracked and flaking, and deposited mail. Savannah thought it odd and gave him a puzzled look. With a simple wave, the mailman acknowledged Savannah and EJ's presence before driving on.
"Why is he delivering mail?"
EJ asked.
"I have no idea."
"He's stupid then,"
EJ sneered.
"He must have his reasons."
What they could be, she had no idea and didn't care, as she had bigger things to think about, like when Susie was coming home, and which Susie would they encounter.
"Will it hurt?"
EJ asked.
"Will what hurt?" "Dying."
Savannah took her attention off the road and fixed it on EJ.
"Are you thinking about that? You aren't?"
She didn't answer. She stared at him with amazement. For someone so young, he was a deep thinker with a profound mind. Maybe it was his childhood, she thought.
"We are products of our nurturing, or lack thereof,"
she chuckled in her mind. Many people had often commented about how mature she was for only being 12. She hadn't paid much attention to those comments until a year ago. Her mother's sponsor, Chad from AA, repeatedly said that of her. He'd comment about how she kept eye contact with everyone, especially adults, when she talked. She didn't deliberately tell herself to do such a thing. She had always done it. Speaking of her mother's sponsor, Chad, he'd called to check in, but after too many calls,
Susie had disconnected the phone from the wall. Will there be a big explosion? Will it break into pieces and fall apart?
Jarred from her thoughts, she shook her head and asked,
Huh? The Earth! Will it break into pieces? I don't know. Will we hear it?
Savannah cocked her head and asked,
Is this what you spend your time thinking about? That and other stuff? Like what? Do you believe in heaven? Yeah, sure. Will...
EJ scrunched his face. He put his lower lip in his mouth and sucked. Seeing this, Savannah knew he was stressed.
What is it?
He stopped playing with the dead leaves and looked at her.
If there is a heaven and we all go there, will Mama be there? Probably. I mean, yeah, she will.
Savannah sat back and sighed, unsatisfied with her answer.
But isn't heaven for good people?
Savannah opened her mouth to reply, but cut herself off.
I don't think she'll be there. Nope. And I don't want her there,
EJ stated firmly. Savannah felt a wave of emotion rush over her. She hated her life and had dreamt about doing so many wonderful things. Now none of it mattered. She didn't know much about religion or God, as she'd never been inside a church, not once. She had wondered if there was a God, and if there was, how could he make people suffer, especially children like them? What sort of God allowed this?
I'm gonna go see what came. Maybe it's something special,
EJ chirped. He hopped off the bucket and ran down the red brick sidewalk to the mailbox. He opened it and peered right in, as he and the mailbox were the same height. He reached in and came out with a stack of what looked like junk mail, mostly. Cradling it in his arms, he carried it back, dropping a couple of flyers along the way.
I'll put it on the table for Mama.
Savannah shrugged her shoulders. The sound of a rumbling engine came from down the road. It was familiar. One Savannah knew all too well.
Mama's coming!
EJ appeared in the doorway.
Should we hide? I don't know, but be prepared to.
Susie turned into the drive, but pulled further in to allow a truck to park behind her. Seeing this, Savannah knew what it meant.
Head upstairs! Is she mad?
EJ asked.
Just head upstairs!
Savannah snapped and gave him a hard look. Always obedient, EJ turned on a dime and raced down the hall and up the stairs. Staying behind to get a good gauge of her mother's condition, Savannah waited. The door of the Toyota Corolla creaked when she opened it. She put one leg out, then another, and paused before standing. She looked towards the front porch and saw Savannah watching.
Hey, baby!
She hollered, with her happy, drunk tone. It was the way she spoke when she was flirting with men and wanted them to believe she was a good mother. A man exited the truck and stumbled a few feet before getting his legs under him.
This is where you live, huh? I always wondered who lived in this old house.
Little old me,
Susie laughed, pointing a finger at herself. She took a half step back and almost fell back into her car. Giving the man a look, she asked,
Did you bring some beer?
You know it,
he exclaimed. He went back to the cab of his truck and removed a wet paper sack. He held it high.
Let's party like it's the end of the fucking world!
He caught sight of Savannah and laughed.
Oops, sorry.
Pay no mind. She's heard worse.
Susie smirked. The contents of the bag broke through and onto the ground. A couple of cans burst open, spraying him with lukewarm beer.
Damn it!
Alcohol abuse,
she cackled.
Best shotgun those babies.
Savannah had seen enough. She knew exactly what tonight was going to be like. She got up, went inside the house, and climbed the 26 stairs to the walk-up attic, where she found EJ playing with some toys.
Who's that with Mama? A friend. Wanna play a game?
EJ asked, with pleading eyes.
Sure. Let's play a game.
She grabbed an old radio, turned it on, and cranked up the volume, as she always did when her mother came home with a friend.
There are reports circulating that Colossus will miss us. Folks, while I have prayed for that to be true, those reports are just plain fake news. Colossus will arrive with all its fury on February 2nd, so get your affair.
Savannah changed the frequency until she found a song she loved by the Beastie Boys titled Sabotage and turned it up loud. She had become a fan of harder music like rock and heavy metal. She faced EJ to see him holding up a deck of Uno and a regular set of cards.
You choose.
Let's play war, Savannah said, and sat down cross-legged. EJ shuffled the cards as best he could with his small hands.
Savannah?
Yeah.
Is Mama gonna hurt us tonight? Can we not talk about it and just play cards? I got a bad bruise from yesterday.
He set the cards down and lifted his shirt to show the deep blue and black softball-sized bruise on his right side.
I'm sorry, but mine is worse, she countered.
She pulled up her sleeve to show a bruise and deep red scratch marks. The two shared a glance only they could. Theirs was a shared experience.
Why does she hurt us? Mama is hurting herself. She's sad and doesn't know what to do with all that sadness. But we didn't hurt her. I know. But sometimes hurt people. So Daddy hurt her, so she hurts us? Yeah, it's like that. Seems silly, but that's what adults do. Silly like the mailman delivering mail? Yeah. Like the mailman delivering mail.
EJ started to deal the deck.
I'll do my best to protect you next time, Savannah said. You promise?
There it was. That word Savannah hated. Promise? How could she do such a thing? She'd heard that word from their dad and Susie all her life, and all they ever did was fail to live up to it. For her, she never wanted to utter that word unless she meant it. EJ began to cry.
What's wrong? I don't want her to hurt me again.
Savannah's heart ached. She reached out, took EJ's hand, and said,
I'll protect you. And I promise she won't hurt you again, ever.
EJ leapt over to Savannah and into her arms. As they embraced, Savannah pondered just how she was going to keep her promise. Chapter 6, Flagstaff, Arizona. A series of gunshots in the distance startled Melody and the large gathering of people she was passing on the street. She lowered her head and looked around for someone with a gun, but saw no one. The group scattered, some running in front of her car to get away. She weaved around two abandoned cars, a more common occurrence as people ran out of gas due to fuel shortages. Glancing at her phone to help navigate, she saw she was drawing close. She made a right turn, and there, three houses down, sat Jared's truck. Her heart sank, and a lump grew in her throat. She questioned what she was doing for a moment, but came to the conclusion she needed to know whom he was with. She parked a house down so as not to draw attention if Jared or whomever he was with looked out the window. She was hoping to catch him by surprise. As she opened her door, a couple of teens on bicycles sped by. She yelped and took a pause to catch her breath.
Stupid kids,
she growled under her breath. Out of the car, she again hesitated, her eyes fixed on the house. She took a couple of steps and stopped. What would she say? What if he was with another woman? Then what? She ran scenarios of encounters, and each one had her standing tall in righteousness, telling him how much of a loser he was. But deep down, she couldn't escape the fact that she'd be devastated.
Could this really be happening?
Of course, when she got real, the signs were there. He was always on his phone, always posting to Instagram pics of him from the gym. This was no doubt to seek attention, or was it just narcissism? Probably both. She had vowed not to date another narcissist. Yet here she was with one, and now he's probably hooking up with some woman from the gym, or whom he'd met on social media. After her last disastrous relationship, she'd vowed to never date a controlling man. But she did. Was it their confidence she found intoxicating, or something else? Either way, it was her fault, as she'd never really done the real work on herself, and she'd met Jared online. A fact she hated to remind herself of was, he'd been dating someone at that time. This was karma for sure, she thought. She took a few more steps, and again paused. With a clenched jaw, she muttered,
"Just do it, Mel."
Fueled to just rip off the Band-Aid, she shoved her phone in her pocket and marched up to the front door. With a fist, she banged loudly, then listened. Seconds went by and no response. She banged more. Curtains of the window next to the door moved.
"Jared, open this door!"
"Go away, Mel!" Jared shouted behind the closed door.
"I won't leave! Not until you tell me what's going on!"
Unintelligible chatter sounded behind the door.
"I hear you talking! Open up!"
she barked.
"No, I'll tell her!"
a woman shouted before the door flew open. 2 feet separated Melody and this strange woman. Tabitha was her name. With her arms firmly planted on her hips, a smirk of disgust written on her face, Melody sized her up. She was about her height, maybe an inch shorter, large breasts, long brown hair pulled back in a ponytail, and a sleeve tattoo on her left arm. Behind her, Jared cowered, his eyes unable to keep contact with hers when she looked.
"What do you want?" Tabitha asked. "I'm here to see my fiancé. He doesn't want to see you."
Melody looked at Jared, who sheepishly looked down and asked,
"Is that true?"
Jared remained quiet. His silence drew condemnation from Tabitha. She cocked her head towards him and exclaimed,
"Tell her!" "Yeah, tell me."
"You see," Jared stuttered, then went quiet. He looked down at his feet and mumbled something unintelligible under his breath. For a man who stood over 6 feet...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.